Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship as we begin a new week together on this beautiful summer day that God has given us. A day that opens up into a week of lots of different ways that we live out the call to be the body of Christ. One of those ways this week is we get to serve some of us together in the banquet in Sioux Falls as we serve some of the poor neighbors in our region, and we do that as a sign of God's love to us and through us. We also this week, some of us will be going on a bus trip at the end of the week and just celebrating the ability of fellowship and community. This week also as a congregation we'll celebrate two weddings, but we'll also mourn with two families and funerals. A lot of life before us as a congregation this week, and we begin that week and that week together of life in worship, and that's the appropriate way to begin. As we do that this morning, a couple of special things. One, if you're here for Kata Vandenberg's Profession of Faith, we welcome you. We get to witness as a church one of the milestones of the journey of faith that we're all on, where Kata will tell us publicly of her commitment to Jesus Christ. Also tonight, we're going to hear some of our youth who have been to California serving in Christ's name. They're back with us, and they're going to be sharing what God did in and through them on that trip, and that'll be this evening at our 6 p.m. service. So with both the morning and the evening, celebrating God's faithfulness to our youth. Also, just a reminder, this morning, right after the service, we did the same thing last Sunday. We're doing a review of worship. We do that every year as a worship planning committee. We do every month. We review each service every year. We step back. We're inviting the congregation to be part of that. Last week, we did it. If you weren't able to make it last week, we're doing the exact same thing this week. And so it'll be right after the service in the gym's room. If you want to talk about worship at all, that's an opportunity for you this morning. With all of that life before us in the service and in this week, would you please open the service praying with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you as we begin this week together, a week filled with opportunities to serve, to play, to celebrate in weddings, to mourn in funerals, and in it all to recognize that you are a God who walks with us. Heavenly Father, we thank you that each of us here today, no matter what is before us in this week, do not enter a week alone, because you are with us and you have given us this family to walk with us as well. Heavenly Father, we pray that your Spirit would move in this place, that you would shape us and mold us, that you would challenge us, that you would heal us, that you would wipe our tears away, and that you would turn our eyes to Jesus. For we pray this in his name. Amen. Friends, would you please stand for our call to worship? This morning, our call to worship comes to us from Psalm 134. Praise the Lord, all you servants of the Lord, who minister by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands in the sanctuary and praise the Lord. May the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, bless you from Zion. The psalm reminds us that God is our blessing and that all our blessings come from him. Let's acknowledge that in song singing, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, number 486.
Thank you.
Friends, as a family called to rejoice with those who rejoice, to mourn with those who mourn, we receive the greeting of our God, who also in all seasons is our Father. To those who are called, who are beloved by God the Father and kept safe in Jesus Christ, grace, mercy, and peace be to each of you now and forevermore. Amen. As God's people beginning a week together, would you please turn and greet those around you, especially our guests this morning. Friends, you may be seated. Next week, Sunday evening, we're going to celebrate communion, and God invites us even this week to prepare ourselves to receive that sign of grace. And this morning, he calls us into a posture of confession through the song calling us to surrender, I surrender all. Let's sing this as a call to confession, and we'll follow it with a prayer. Of surrender, let's come to God in confession. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we begin this week in your presence, and we do desire to surrender all. And yet, as we review the week that's been, we must confess this morning that we have not surrendered all, that we have not acknowledged that all that we have is yours, that we have not acknowledged that all that we are is yours, that we have spent this week seeking to earn and save and spend, using our lives to build little kingdoms for ourselves, to build safety nets for ourselves and our families, clutching on to the gifts that you've given, not trusting our lives, not trusting our gifts, not trusting our past, present, and future to you. Heavenly Father, in a world that is wrecked by a desire for more money, help us to be people who with courage and boldness and humility surrender all. And in surrender, find not only your forgiveness, but also freedom. New joy, new peace, as we recognize that our lives and our families and our futures and all that we have and are held in your hands. And so, Father, in Christ, we ask for your forgiveness, and we do surrender all. Praying in Jesus' name, amen. We hear God's word of assurance and challenge from Philippians chapter 3. But whatever it was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes by God and is by faith. We are forgiven and given righteousness not because of what we've earned or what we've gained, but because what we are given in Jesus. And there's nothing greater, therefore, Paul says, than knowing him. Let's respond singing together, Knowing You. Prayer is that we would always, us and if we have children or grandchildren or nephews and nieces, that all of us would know this Christ. And today we celebrate with the family As Kata comes before us and simply acknowledges that she does know the one who has known her fully, even as she is fully known. And with that, we are celebrating profession of faith. And this is a sign that Kata was recognized and welcomed into the covenant community at baptism. But now she not only is going to tell us that she knows Jesus, but she is going to commit before us to live the rest of her life in obedience to him as not just Savior, but also as Lord. So with that before us, I'd like to invite Kata up to make her profession of faith. Okay, we're just going to gather on the baptismal font here. Now, when you became a lifeguard, what was your final test?
Saving a dummy.
You had to save a dummy, right? And that's what God does all the time. He saves lots of dummies. And this is a sign that God has saved you. But I want you to think about what this is. This isn't like a lifeguard training where you have swam your laps and you've saved someone and you're saying to the world, hey, I've got this. Profession of faith is actually like you're splashing in the water saying, I need someone to save me. I don't have this. You're coming and you're saying publicly that you need a Savior and that you found that Savior in Christ. So with that, I'm going to invite you to answer these four questions, Kata. First, this most important one. Do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, sent to redeem the world, and do you love and trust him as the one who saves you from your sin, and do you with repentance and joy embrace him as Lord of your life? Kata, what is your answer? Second question, do you believe that the Bible is the Word of God, revealing Christ and his redemption, and that the confessions of this church faithfully reflect that biblical revelation? What is your answer?
I do.
Thirdly, do you accept the gracious promise of God made to you at your baptism, and do you affirm your union with Christ and his church, which your baptism signifies? What is your answer?
I do.
And then finally, this question, Kata. Do you promise to do all that you can with the help of the Holy Spirit to strengthen your love and commitment to Christ by sharing faithfully in the life of the church, honoring and submitting to its authority, and do you join with the people of God in doing the work of the Lord everywhere? Kata, what is your answer? Praise God. Would you just face the body of Christ, this family? Brothers and sisters, we have received Kata at her baptism into the covenant community. Now do you welcome her in love at the table of the Lord, and do you continue to promise to pray for her and to support her by word and example in her walk with Jesus Christ? Congregation at Bethel, what is our answer?
We do, God have mercy.
We've got a crowd of saints around there, Kata, and on behalf of them, I want to give you a gift, and then we're going to pray for you. The gift is a Bible. You can take this in life. It's a sword. And the front of it is your favorite verse, Psalm 150, verse 6, the very last verse in the Psalms. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We pray that your life will be filled with praise to God. And with that, I want to welcome you to all the privileges of full communion. I welcome you to full participation in the life of the church. I welcome you to its responsibilities, its joys, and its sufferings. I do so with the prayer that God would bless you and keep you always. With that, I'd like to invite Dan, our youth pastor, up. Also, your family, Kata, and any youth leaders, anyone who would like to pray with Kata, this is an opportunity to come up to do so.
As this group is coming up, I'd just like to share a couple words too. As a passionate and gifted dancer, I just want to look at the imagery of dancing, and more specifically, the part that music plays. If you're dancing by yourself, nobody really knows what's going on, but if you're dancing to a song, you're kind of led by the song, you're led by the rhythm, by the beat, all around here. And so just as you think about the role that music plays, and as you're dancing, think about music being God and how the beat can emphasize everything that you're doing as a dancer. And even if you're out of step or if you're out of beat, how if you're doing a move when you're supposed to be going this way and you're going the wrong way or something like that, if you're out of touch with a song, it's not going to look right. It's not going to feel right. So the more you are in line with God, the more you're in line with the music, it's going to be a beautiful performance that you enjoy, that you connect with, but also that other people do as spectators. And just like music, just like dance, is almost an invitation. If you see somebody really getting into it, you want to experience that as well. So just that your life can be an invitation for other people to join in and follow the music as well. So let's pray. If you guys would extend a hand forward in blessing as well, and just lay a hand on Kata, we'll pray a blessing over her. Our Heavenly Father, we rejoice this morning in this decision that Kata has made to commit her life to you. And we pray that as she sets out on this journey, that you will bring alongside of her family, friends, even complete strangers that can just encourage her, that can strengthen her, that can just point her towards you. And I pray, God, as she steps out boldly in faith, that you will hold her, that you will protect her, keep her from the fiery arrows of the enemy. And God, I pray that when she does experience pain, when she does experience heartache and trouble, that she can cling to you all the tighter and that she can know that she is held in your hands. I pray that her life can be a living example of your love and your grace. And God, as she continues to go through high school and continues to build relationships, I just pray, God, that that she can follow the music that you give to us, that she can follow your lead, and that she can just glorify you with the life that she lives, that that can be a pleasing sight, a pleasing image for you. We ask all this in your son's name. Amen.
Thank you. Yeah, welcome, Kata. We're going to celebrate this milestone by hearing a song reminding us what profession of faith signifies, that we are no longer slaves, that we are children of God. As children of God, I invite you to turn with me in the Old Testament. We're in the book of Malachi. It's the last book in the Old Testament. Today we're going to be in chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. It's found beginning on page 887 in our Pew Bibles. If you have your own Bible, you're welcome to turn to, but keep it please open. Let's walk through this part of God's Word, Malachi chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. If you're a guest with us, we've been in the summer months walking through this Old Testament book, the very final book before Christ's coming. And just to give you a sense for where we are, next week Sunday we're actually going to finish this book. The week after that, my wife and I hope to go to Michigan for a week to see my family and all my siblings and parents. And then when I come back, the last Sunday in August is going to be a single sermon on Christian education as we begin church education year, a new school year, and as we begin silage piles, why do we do all this? What is our vision for Christian education? That'll be the last Sunday. And then Lord willing, in the fall semester, we're going to begin looking at not an Old Testament book, but a New Testament book, the letter of 1 John, a very challenging book, and I'm excited to walk through that part of God's Word together in the fall. So next week, Sunday, we'll finish the book of Malachi. In the second to last sermon, Malachi, this 2,005-year-old prophecy, takes us to talk about money. And as we do that this morning, let's just acknowledge this is a hard topic to talk about, even through an old prophecy that God has given us. I say hard because one theologian says this: giving to God's work in the church and in the world is one of the last and hardest areas of life to surrender to Christ's lordship. You could say that our biggest struggle in discipleship is probably not our sexuality. It's not in our relationships. It's in our relationship with money. And today, God's going to be speaking to that part of our lives. And so we're going to acknowledge this could be challenging for us. It always is for all of us. But I also want to put this passage in context of the bigger story of Scripture. Malachi chapter 3, talking about tithing, is one of the key passages people often go to when it comes to giving. But it's not a passage that exists in isolation. A couple of years ago, we did a four-week series on financial stewardship. And if you remember, we saw that the whole story of Scripture is woven with the story of generosity. So we began the four-week series with creation, and we saw that God made everything and God owns everything. And so our role in the world is as stewards. We simply steward what belongs to God. Then we looked at the fall and we saw that our relationship with money is distorted. Greed, materialism, idolatry, that money deceives us and it enslaves us because of the fall. Then we moved to redemption and we saw that our giving is a result of our gratitude. That because God has given us salvation, our giving no longer seeks to achieve salvation, but it is a response of gratitude to it. And then we moved to the new creation and redemption, and we saw that we can't take money with us, but we can send it on ahead, that we live and give as citizens of a coming world, a coming kingdom. And so that's the big story of Scripture. In Malachi chapter 3 is not exist in isolation, but is part of that fabric of generosity that God is telling us. So with that before us this morning, I invite you to pray with me as God speaks. Heavenly Father, we hear in profession of faith our need for a Savior. And as we talk about money, we acknowledge that we need to be saved. But also in profession of faith, we talk about receiving you as Lord. And we acknowledge our struggle in this part of our lives to truly entrust ourselves and our possessions to you. To recognize that we are stewards, that you are master. So, Father, may you speak by your Holy Spirit and word today. A word beyond what I can speak, a word of challenge, but also of blessing. A world that opens up a door to us of a new way of living, a new way of approaching you, a new way of experiencing your joy. For, Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Malachi chapter 3, beginning at verse 6. God says, I, the Lord, do not change. So you, O descendants of Jacob, are not destroyed. Ever since the time of your forefathers, you have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord Almighty. But you ask, how are we to return? Will a man rob God? Yet you rob me. But you ask, how do we rob you? In tithes and offerings. You are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have room enough for it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not cast their fruit, says the Lord Almighty. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land, says the Lord Almighty. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Historical figure that's been in the news a fair amount recently is a man named John Dillinger. He's been in the news partly because on July 22 was the 85th anniversary of when he was gunned down by J. Edgar Hoover's FBI in an alley outside a theater in Chicago. He was gunned down because he was considered public enemy number one. He was a notorious Depression-era bank robber. He and his gang, the Dillinger Gang, robbed some 24 banks, hundreds of thousands of dollars. Most wanted, the FBI did a massive manhunt for him. 85th anniversary, July 22 of his death. But he's also been in the news because just in this past week, his family had won a court case allowing them to dig up his body, which is no small task because it was buried with 5,000 pounds of concrete. Ironically, because they didn't want anyone to steal the bank robber's body. Irony. They're going to dig it up because the family is wondering if they actually buried John Dillinger or if it was an imposter and Don Dillinger was still alive. Maybe this famous bank robber still walked among us. As you think about that notorious bank robber so long ago, the truth is other robbers do walk among us. We know this from the newspaper, but they also walk a little bit more closely. Well, you'd imagine a news report about a local church that also experienced a robbery, but it wasn't John Dillinger. Police don't actually know how much money was taken. It's an undetermined amount. It's probably tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of dollars. The worst part about it, though, are a number of facts. First of all, it was an inside job. It apparently was many of the members of the congregation who actually were in on the crime, including possibly the pastor. Even worse than that, this robbery occurred in broad daylight during a worship service as the offering plates were passed by. Now, it wasn't a robbery where any money was physically taken out of the plates or the safe. It was actually a robbery for money that was meant to be given by God, but that never was. Some of the victims would be people around the world who needed to hear the gospel, people in our community who needed help, but the real victim actually was God. That people of God in the midst of a worship service robbed God himself. That image that there's a little John Dillinger in every one of us is maybe an insulting image for us. It's a striking image, but it is the image that we need to wrestle with from the book of Malachi, where God says to his people, "You are robbing me." What do we do with that image, that message from God? Well, as we look at this passage, we see God begins with a theological observation about himself. Verse 6, he says, "I, the Lord, do not change, therefore you are not consumed." God makes a theological observation about himself, and theologians call that the doctrine of immutability. The idea that God does not change in his will, in his character, in his covenant promise and faithfulness. So God says, "I do not change." But then he applies that pastoral observation, that theological observation, and he makes a pastoral implication for us in verse 7. "Ever since the time your forefathers have turned away from my decrees and have not kept them, return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord." In other words, what he's saying is, I do not change, which means I give you an opportunity to change. Return, repent. Change. I don't change. I'm always faithful, which gives you the opportunity to change. But what needs to be changed? Well, once again, we have one of these seven dialogues in the book of Malachi where God says something. God's people sarcastically say, "How is that true?" And we see here a double dialogue. Notice what this returning needs to involve. But you ask, "How are we to return to you?" And God responds, "Will a man rob God? Yet you rob me." And then they respond again, "But how do we rob you?" And he responds, "In tithes and offerings." Three different ways there. God says, a man robbed God, you rob me, how do we rob you? God says there's a little John Dillinger in every one of his people. And then he says that again in verse 9 for a fourth time. You are under a curse, the whole nation of you, because you are robbing me. Now again, that's a striking image. But it also is a clear teaching. What is God teaching us about giving in Malachi chapter 3? Well, three things. First of all, he's teaching us how much should we give. Notice verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. Now, the word tithe, in our language, you often mean a gift. So people will say, I got $100, I tithed $2 to God. That's not a tithe. Because a tithe means technically, literally, it means the tenth part or 10%. So God says, bring the whole tithe, the Hebrew word ma'aser, the tenth part into the storehouse. The first time we see that is in Genesis 14, where Abraham, returning from battle, gives a tenth part, a tithe, to a man named Melchizedek. We also see that later on with Jacob in Genesis 28, where he says, I have set up a pillar, will be God's house, and all that you give me, speaking to God, I will give you a tenth, a tithe. That's codified into law all through the Torah. I'm just pulling out one example, Leviticus 27. A tithe of everything from the land, whether grain from the soil or fruit from the trees, belongs to the Lord. It is holy to the Lord. The entire tithe of the herd, every tenth animal that passes under the shepherd's rod, will be holy to the Lord. Now notice here, a tithe again is a tenth part. It's of everything, gross or net, doesn't include my bonus, it's of everything. And it's not just as a suggestion, you maybe should consider giving it. It belongs to the Lord. If it's not given, you have robbed him. It is holy or set apart. How much do we give? 10%, a tenth part of everything. Second thing that it tells us is a clear teaching, where do we give this? Notice again verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse. Now that is a part of God's temple in Jerusalem. People would bring it there, and that's what the priests would use in worship. It's what they used to care for the poor, but it was to bring to God's house. He says that a second time, that there may be food in my house, in my temple. Deuteronomy 26 says the same thing. Go to the place the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name, the temple. The priest shall take the basket from your hands and set it down in front of the altar of the Lord your God. What do you give? A tenth. Where do you give it? Not to pay for the cable bill of your mother-in-law or to do good works. You bring it to God's house, to his priests. And then thirdly, why should you do this? Well, there's a negative and a positive reason given in Malachi. Notice the negative. You are under a curse because you are robbing me. So one of the reasons you want to give is so you're not cursed, so you don't rob God. But there's also not just a stick, there's a carrot. God says, he hardly ever says this. Normally he says, I test you. He says, now test me, says the Lord Almighty. And see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that you will not have enough room for it. Then the nations will call you blessed, for yours will be a delightful land. A difficult image, robbing God, but a clear teaching. And what's the clear teaching? What is tithing? Well, Dave Ramsey defines it this way, right from Malachi. Simply put, the tithe is the first 10% of your income that should be given to your local worshiping community. And we could add to that, is a doorway or a key to open God's blessing on your life. Tithe is 10% given to your local worshiping community, and the result of that is blessings for you if you do it. How many of us understand a tithe that way? Right? That's what we're kind of taught. 10% to God's worshiping community, and he'll bless you. It's what Malachi says. How do we receive that clear teaching? Well, the truth is we receive it different ways. First of all, often church leaders like me, we love this teaching. We just love it. I think we love it for three reasons. One, we love it because it's aspirational and yet attainable. The average Christian in the U.S. gives 2.5% of their income to God. That's not a tithe. 10%, though, that's aspirational. We're asking you to do something. If you were averaging 14%, we wouldn't preach about tithing. But since you're 2.5, this gives you something to grow in. But it's also attainable. Most of us could probably do it. We also like it because it's applicable. It's easy. It's math. It's simple. If you make $10, how much should you give? A dollar. If you make $100, how much should you give? If you make $1,000? And even at complex numbers, if you make $222, what should you give? $22.20. You just move the decimal point. It's so easy. If all sermons could be this easy, it'd be wonderful, wouldn't it? So it's aspirational and attainable. It is applicable, but also it's motivational. We pastors can use this teaching to motivate you to obey Christ. One of the ways is with the negative, with that stick. So some churches have this. Will a man rob God? Malachi 3:8, the non-tithers board, and there's a list of people who aren't tithing. The deacons are considering this. We can also, another church sign talks about debt. What does debt mean? Doing everything but tithing. If you're in debt, it's your fault. You are under the curse. You're not under blessing. We can motivate you with a stick, or we can motivate you with a carrot. 90% with God's blessing is better than 100% without the blessed life. When I was in Nicaragua, most of the churches were small. The pastors were bivocational, and whatever came in the offering plate largely went for their salary. Guess what passage, whenever I went to small churches in the villages, probably half the time I was there, I'm hardly kidding, was what passage? Malachi chapter 3. I heard this again and again and again in Nicaragua. I can quote this in Spanish. And they would often say, you're poor, yes, but that's because you're robbing God. And if you give to God, God's going to give to you. If you trust your money to him, he's going to give you so much money back, you're not going to know what to do with it. That's what I heard again and again. We church leaders love this. How about you church members? Well, maybe not so much. July 10 was another anniversary. It was the anniversary of the killing of the patron saint of Denmark, a man named King Canute IV. He's now considered the patron saint of Denmark. When he was a king, he wasn't a saint, but he loved God and he rebuilt many churches. He invested in monasteries and he made tithing mandatory. It so angered people that a crowd killed him in front of the altar at church. Deacons, be careful with tithing. Today we don't usually kill people because they make us tithe, but we do other things. In a county in Florida, in Wade County, there was a lawsuit in Dade County, and this is part of the lawsuit. This is a real lawsuit. This man says, I delivered 800 of my savings to the church in response to the pastor's promise of blessings. Benefits and rewards would come to the person who did tithe 10% of his wealth. I did not and have not received those benefits, so he was suing to get his money back. We don't necessarily like this. We also tend to be very cynical when people preach about tithing. I saw this on the internet. You convince people to give 10% of their income by telling them they're robbing God? Tell me more about the art of extortion, right? We're not sure we like this, and so mostly we ignore it. But the truth is today, whether you like this teaching in Malachi 3 or whether you hate it, what I want us to do is to understand it. I think if we actually try to understand it, each of those three things we think we know about tithing needs correction. Is it really 10%? Must it be given to the local church? Does God promise financial blessings? Maybe not to all three of those. First of all, how much should we give? Well, in the Old Testament, was it 10%? The truth is, actually, no. John Ortberg says this. There were actually three tithes collected in Israel. One to support the priests and Levites, that's 10%. Another that you gave for sacred celebrations, for the three pilgrimage festivals, that's another 10%, which adds to 20. And then a third collected once every 3 years. That means every year about 3.33333% is given to the poor. So the actual income percentage was closer to 23.3% than 10%. Ooh, that was the Old Testament. Actually not 10%, 23 1/3%. But of course in the New Testament, does that even matter? Because that was Old Testament law. Malachi's in the Old Testament. How about the New? Well, Jesus speaks about tithing in Matthew 23, verse 23, from the New Living Translation. You are careful to tithe even the tiniest income from your herb gardens, but you ignore the more important aspects of the law, justice, mercy, and faith. And then he says, you should tithe, yes, but do not neglect the more important things. In other words, was tithing rescinded? Well, some people say actually not. Though others will point out this was still during Jesus' ministry before he died. But after he died, we are no longer under the law, we are under grace. Okay, What percentage does grace request? Well, let's look again at Jesus' ministry. A man named Zacchaeus was a tax collector, knew all about numbers and calculations and percentages. When he came to know Christ, what percent did he give away of his wealth? He says, I will give half of it to the poor. And Christ said, salvation's come to this house. He didn't correct him and say, no, that's too much. Just give 10, 90, you know, half. Jesus, yes. There's another story where a rich young man comes to Jesus, and Jesus, we're told in the gospel, loves him. And in love, what does Jesus say to do? Go and do what? Sell all that you have and then come and follow. What percent is his all? 100%. Then there's another story where people are in the temple and they're giving their tithes and their offerings. They're obeying Malachi. There's a woman with two small coins. She can give 0%, 50%, or 100%. She gives 100%. He says, that is the way I want you to give. This is Mr. Grace speaking. In fact, if you look at the New Testament, I don't think we get a percentage. I don't think 10%, that legalism is where Christ wants us to be. But that doesn't mean that's where he doesn't wants us to stop. What we're told in the New Testament is two guidelines. We are to give regularly and proportionally, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, on the first day of every week, this is after the cross, on the first day of every week, each one should set aside a sum of money in keeping with his income. So it's still regular and it's still proportional. But it's also supposed to be sacrificially generous and cheerful. 2 Corinthians 9, remember, whoever sows sparingly will reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will reap generously. Each one should give what he's decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion. So it's not with a calculator, for God loves a cheerful giver. I think in the New Testament, 10% is probably not the legalistic requirement anymore. But that doesn't mean we're off the hook. Irenaeus, a church father who wrote in the second century after Christ, so very early in the church, says this: the Jews were constrained to a regular payment of tithes. Christians who have liberty assign all their possessions to the Lord, bestowing freely not the lesser portion of their property, since they have a hope of greater things. Another new scholar, Randy Alcorn, says, tithing is the training wheels of giving. New Testament grace is not a license that frees us to clutch tighter to material wealth. The bar has been raised. New Testament believers are called upon to be far more sacrificial and generous. Or to quote Ortberg again, tithing is not is a bad ceiling, but an excellent floor. Tithing is not the last word in generosity, it's the first word. In other words, if we think we've given 10% and now we're okay, God might actually still have some challenge for us. Because maybe in the New Testament, that's not the end, that's just the beginning. So maybe our 10% rule is too simple. How about the second understanding? Where do we have to give it? Well, some people very clearly say the temple of the Old Testament is the church of the New. Others, like this next person, says it's not exactly equivalent, but at least it's parallel. One writer says this, Randy Alcorn says, the whole tithe went into the temple for the work of the Levites. The closest parallel today of the temples is the church. The closest parallels of the Levites is the elders. You see this even after Christ in Acts 2, when it says the money was laid at the feet of the apostles, who then decided how to distribute it. In other words, he says there's a lot of continuity here. Others say actually not. The temple in the Old Testament was a one place in the nation. It's where sacrifices were made. In the New Testament, that's replaced by Christ. That in fact, the church today, the local church, is not equivalent to the temple. So what do we do with our money? Where do we give it if we're convicted to give? Well, this is really not a question of right or wrong so much as a question of wisdom. Where does God want us to have our money? We need to pray and collectively discern. But there is some wisdom in recognizing where the heart of our faith is formed. Maybe that's where the heart of our giving is also shared. One writer says this: God has drawn us into a specific community of believers where our whole lives are redeemed by our presence in Holy Communion, Bible studies, Sunday school, and even tedious committee meetings. Can I get an amen? In God's economy, this specific community grinds down the rough edges of our egos and helps us recognize brothers and sisters and people who otherwise would cross neither our minds nor our paths. If we aim to tithe, why would we deprive this specific part of the body of Christ? In other words, in a corrective, if you don't give 10% to Bethel and you give to other causes, I'm not going to say you're robbing God. But maybe there's wisdom in recognizing That the best collective accountability and joy is to share together with those you live with, and then to together serve in Christ's name, not to do that individually. How much do we give? 10%? Well, maybe that's a start. Where do we give? The church, yes, but more than that. Finally, why do we give? Can I make a promise today that if you give money today in the offering plate, God's going to give you more money back? Well, actually, no, we can't make that promise. One scholar says this, Malachi 3:10, that famous verse, "Test me in this and see if I won't open the floodgates of heaven," has become the linchpin for a stream within the charismatic movement, variously called the faith movement, the health and wealth gospel, prosperity theology, name it, claim it. It is a form of forcing God's hand by human activity, taking the unchangeable, remember, immutability, covenant promises of God and misapplying them. If we treat giving like this or the vending machine, put a dollar in, get out a Coke, but there's another machine called tithing, put a dollar in, get $2 out, put 10 in, get a 20 out, we've misread what God is saying in Malachi. This is a covenant promise of a God who says, I've been faithful even when you've been unfaithful, and I want you to test me to see that I will be faithful. And in that economy, he was saying, I'm going to be faithful to my promise to the Holy Land, and I'm going to give you rains, I'm going to hold back pests, and I'm going to give you fruit. But now that promise is no longer tied just to Israel and to agriculture. God will bless when we give, but that blessing may not be in U.S. dollars. It might be in peace. It might be in a deeper sense of rest in God. It might be in a closer fellowship. It might be in the joy of seeing God use your gifts to bless others. It may also be in financial blessings, but that is not the guarantee. All that we think about tithing, God wants to modify and clarify. But in closing, where does that leave us then? Why should we give if we're not guaranteed financial money back? Why should we give? Notice again what Malachi actually says. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord. But you ask, how shall we return? Bring in the whole tithe. God wants the people to return, but he does it by commanding them to bring money. Now, if God wants people, why is he talking about money? If he really wants relationship, why is he talking about revenue? Well, the reason is because God knows that our hearts follow our money. It's not that our money follows our hearts follow our money. All the way back in Deuteronomy, God showed us this. Be sure to set aside a tenth, a tithe of your fields. Eat the tithe of your grain and new wine in the presence of the Lord your God in the place he will choose as a dwelling for his name, so that you may learn to revere the Lord. I want you to tithe, give your money, so that your relationship will follow. Jesus said the same thing in the New Testament. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Your heart follows your treasure, not the other way around. God wants his people in relationship, and he calls them to tithe, not because he wants the revenue, but because in following their money, they will enter into the relationship he desires. Randy Alcorn says this, what we do with our money is more than an indicator of where our heart is. According to, I would say, Deuteronomy, Malachi, and Jesus, it is a determiner of where our heart is. This is an amazing and exciting prospect. If I want my heart to be in one particular place and not in another, then I need to put my money in that place and not in the other. My heart always goes where I put God's money. So you could say that giving or tithing is God's way to lead his people's hearts back to him. Why does God want us to give? It has nothing to do with revenue. It has to do with leading our hearts back so we return to him. What does that mean? How much should you give? Where should you give it? Why should you give it? This isn't an issue of percentages, but of perspective. God doesn't want to change the decimal point in your checkbook. He wants to change the desires of your heart. He is not so interested in giving our change as that we are changed as the offering plate passes by. Because in giving, our hearts are returning to God. It's never been about revenue. It has always been about relationship. How does this look? I could end with many stories, some wonderful, miraculous stories of people who tested God and God blessed them financially or in other ways. I can tell many stories that would inspire you today, and we did reverse offerings a couple of different years, and we've collected some of those stories from you. But as I think about ending this, I reflect on this week. On Tuesday, I visited a member of our church, Herm Brenneman. And we both knew that was probably the last time we would see each other. He was still, when I walked in the room, he said, "Oh, Pastor John." He was fully with it. We talked. Dying of bone cancer. And during that entire visit, I never heard Herm offer one word of complaint or self-pity or fear. The entire visit was Herm giving thanks to God for the blessings of his wife and his family and his church and the life that God had given him. I met with Herm's family yesterday, and they said as you look at his checkbook, you could see what mattered to him. Missions and church, God. He had lived a life by grace, not of robbing God, but of receiving from God the gift of Christ, that big story, creation, fall, redemption, consummation. Not by seeing what percentage do I need to give, but recognizing what God had given and giving money, and in giving money, having his heart follow into relationship with God. So at the end of his life, he leaves a legacy to his family of giving, but also an experience in those closing moments, not of John Dillinger, gunned down in an alley as a robber, but as a saint, no longer a slave, loved by God, and in gratitude, loving God back. That is what Malachi is calling us to. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we acknowledge how hard it is to surrender all. How much we like to spend on ourselves. How fearful we are of the future. How much we hoard. Heavenly Father, may you give us the grace not to rob you, but to receive from you the gift of Christ. And to trust you enough to give our money, and in giving our money, follow that money with our hearts as you call us to return to you with the promise that you will return to us. Father, free us. Give us deeper trust, deeper joy, deeper gladness in you. We pray in Jesus' name, and all of us say, amen. Song response is the reminder that we give to God that which is his own. Psalter hymn number 296. We'll sing stanza 1 and 2, 4 and 5. Please stand if you're able as the music begins. Seated, and we will gratefully bring our offerings this morning, but first we bring our offering of prayer. So do just two announcements. We've had two deaths this week. John Poyce is in the bulletin. Just a reminder, his visitation will be today, this Sunday, at Memorial Funeral Home. Family will be there from 3 to 5, and then the funeral will be here at Bethel tomorrow morning at 10:30. Herm Brenneman's visitation will be Thursday, again at Memorial Funeral Home from 5 to 7, and the funeral will be back here at Bethel on Friday morning at 10:30. Also, just, it's in the bulletin, but our church secretary, Wanda Vandekeef, will be having a knee replacement surgery on Tuesday. Because of that, the office is going to be staffed much more sporadically in the coming weeks. We just ask for your patience, even as we ask for your prayers for Wanda. So with those things, let's come to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, this is the first day of a new week that you've given, a day that you've given that we can rejoice and be glad in. As we stand at the doorway of this week and we look at what lies before us, celebrating this evening the service that you did through our youth in California, traveling to Sioux Falls to serve some of the poor men and women and children of our region at the banquet on Tuesday, grieving on Monday and Friday with families who have lost husbands and fathers, celebrating on Thursday and Saturday with young couples who are committing their lives to each other in you as husband and wife. We see the joy and the sorrow, the service, the fellowship. And at the center of all of this, Father, is you, our God, our Redeemer, our King, our Lord, who through Christ our Savior has become. Heavenly Father, we pray that we would be a community, that whether we gather today with breaking hearts or with great joy, could find in this fellowship, in this family, a place of belonging in Christ. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would help us, young and old, married and single men and women, to serve you, not just with our finances, yes, with them, but also with our lives, with our gifts, with our talents, with all that we have and are. Heavenly Father, we thank you in this week for the service that you gave through leaders as they led our cadets in a regional camporee at Newton Hills. We thank you for each of the boys who participated, and we pray that as they learned about you, about the gifts that you gave them and the service that they give as a result, that you would plant your seed in each life, that this would have been a week of salvation, of encountering you. Heavenly Father, we do pray as we hear an opportunity to review our worship services again after the Sunday service, that you would bless Jennifer Friends as she leads that part of our ministry, each of our planners, our musicians, praise team members, sound members, all who serve behind the scenes for these worship services. Lord, we thank you that we are a family and each one has been given gifts and we use our gifts together to build up this body and to glorify your name. Heavenly Father, we do this week pray for our missionaries who bring the same message of salvation around the world. Pray that you would encourage them, that you would provide through our gifts what they need to serve well. Heavenly Father, we also pray for the churches of our community. Today we pray for Peace Lutheran, Pastor Bill, and that congregation. May they also be salt and light in this world. Heavenly Father, we need your salt and light in a world that is so broken. Once again, we grieve at another shooting yesterday. 20 dead, 26 wounded in the Walmart of El Paso, Texas. Father, the violence and the fear and the anger of this world crowds into our lives, and we pray that you would help your church even now in El Paso, to speak a word of healing, to speak a word of forgiveness, of reconciliation, of justice, of righteousness, of your kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven, even in brokenness. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray for our world. We continue to pray for places torn by war and unrest, for our missionaries working in Ukraine and in Nicaragua, for those working in Venezuela, in Syria, for those welcoming refugees across North America and in Europe, so many men, women, and children displaced from their homes. Father, may we be a place in your kingdom, the church, a place of welcome, a place that gives sacrificially and generously so that the poor of this world would recognize and encounter you as a Savior. And Father, we do pray in this week for Wanda Vandekeef as she goes into surgery on Tuesday. May you bless that procedure. May you give her patience in the days of recovery and therapy. Heavenly Father, may those who are filling in the office for her in these coming weeks also experience a special measure of your grace as you multiply their time also. Father, we continue to pray with Brian and Becky Grunewig and their preterm daughter, Iris. We thank you for his progress as it's been made, but also pray that you continue to guard Iris's life, to help her to grow strong and well. Lord, may you watch over this family. Gracious God, we continue to pray for those who are recovering from surgeries, who are dealing with chronic diseases and chronic pain, with mental illness, with the quiet struggles that we name only to you in this place. Father, we lift before you our families too, those who are walking roads of cancer treatment, those who are wandering from the faith, those marriage relationships that are strained. Lord, we pray that you in all ways would be our healer. Heavenly Father, we again lift before you today Helen, as she grieves John's death, we lift before you Adeline and her family as they grieve Herm's death. We pray that in this week you would help us to be a sign of your Spirit as you walk beside these grieving women. So Heavenly Father, receive our prayers, receive now our offerings. And as we give them, may by your grace our hearts follow as you restore us to deep relationship, to deep trust, to deep joy, finding our all in you. For we pray in Jesus' name, amen. We give our offerings now, the first for the ministries of this congregation, denomination around the world, the second for Christian education. Thank you. Finish the service. Just want to invite you back again at 6 p.m. tonight. We're going to focus on what it means to hallow God's name, and we'll hear our youth as they report of their serve trip to California. After the service this morning, I invite you to welcome, congratulate Kata with me in the back door after the service, and also spend some time if you're a guest with us, a longtime member, over cookies and punch and coffee, enjoying the fellowship of God's family this morning. And with that, to close, and also a reminder for worship, anyone who wants to talk about worship, Jim's room immediately after the service this morning. With that before us, our closing song is May the Peace. It's a newer song for some of us, so we're going to stand, receive God's blessing. We're going to hear that song sung through once, and then we'll join the second time through May the Peace. But first, would you stand for God's blessing? Brothers and sisters in Christ, may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, may he strengthen you in every good deed and word. Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. Amen.
Please.